गुड मॉर्निंग माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स, एम आई ऑडिबल टू यू? हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल टू यू गाइस? ओके ओके, थैंक यू. Upender just now joined and left. Roll number 450. While registering, don't leave the space in between your digits of your roll number. 450. You left space after A. In spite of many repetitions, if people are doing the same, repeating the same, you are going to be employees in a short span of time. Is this the way you work in a company? Still waiting for the people to join. Till now only 70 members are present in the class. Shall I message in the class group for others to join? Yeah, I'll put a message. I'll wait for 2 more minutes and I will start. Patri Upender has come to the class. Yesterday also he was absent. Yeah, good morning all of you once again. Faninder, Patri Faninder, how are you, Faninder? Are you there in the class, Faninder? Yesterday you were absent to the class. Why? Am I audible, Faninder? You can respond through voice. I have not yet muted you. You can respond through voice or through the chat box. still 82 members only joined the class. Okay, we further we cannot wait. Let the people whoever have not joined, let them join in the due course. So before that, let us start our class. So we have been studying about the GPS applications in detail. So GPS originally meant for the military applications, but later on it has opened up its wings in many applications like military navigation, air navigation, marine navigation, and also the land navigation. So let me share today's presentation. Okay. Yesterday we have seen something called as pressure forming, in which there is a swath duster, that is pesticides or fertilizers spraying machine. With the help of the helicopter, it will be done. Please watch the video. Is this visible to you? Yeah, it is spraying the it is called swath duster, and there will be a pilot present inside. Swath duster pilot, we call him as. And this is one of the techniques under the heading precision farming. So this is called crop duster spraying. I will make it to screen. Just wait. You can observe it once again. So this is navigated through the GPS. This helicopter, whatever you are seeing, the flight. This is navigated through the GPS to spray the pesticides and the farming. Of course, these kind of technologies are present in USA. Shortly in India also we may expect. I think some of you are doing projects, right? On smart agriculture or automated agriculture with these titles. Right. So this is one of the applications of the precision farming application, like pesticides or herbicides, whatever it is, some of the fertilizers, we need to spray upon our farming land or the crop if it is infected, or for the growth of it, or for the to improve the yielding of the crop, we use this. I think agriculture background people will understand this very clearly. And this is made pilotless, unmanned flights, because sometimes this may be harmful, right? So these are the some of the applications of the GPS. And of course, we have also studied the GPS application in the aircraft landing system. In the aircraft landing system, where from en route to approach, there are different stages in the aircraft landing system. Of course, from this is the crew required in the aircraft is also decreased to a very less. So military and space applications we started. So for the first time in 1960s, the GPS was designed to satisfy the military requirements only. For the evolution of the GPS itself is for the military requirements for worldwide positioning, navigation, and timing service. To position the, of course, whatever it is in the warfare navigation, and also to provide the proper timing. This is the primary aim of the GPS. So if this is enabled or integrated with a satellite, then satellite-based system will ensure the global coverage. So these signals have to enable very accurate fixes and to resist the enemies in the jamming, So how this can be achieved? By using the receiver antennas such that they will nullify in some directions. So wherever the enemies are expected, in those directions, the radiation pattern will be nullified. In others, wherever the actual signal is to be received, the signal strength will be high. Of course, this topic we already learned this. And this should be authenticated, and it should have more security. To provide the security features, we are encrypting the P code, and we are using a Y code. That is, encrypted P code is called as the Y code. And the key of this Y code will be known to only some authorized users, not to the commercial users or the civilian users. Of course, some of the modernized receivers are also using the M code, and it is even more robust signal, which is dispersed spectrum properties allow for allied forces to jam in the band center to interfere with the adversary receivers that are trying to use the C by A code signals without disturbing their use of the their own use of the M code. So there are some not only the US forces and their allied users, their allied forces are there. So their allied forces will be allowed to use the C by A code in addition with the M code, in addition with the M code, without disturbing their use of the M code. And of course, we have studied this. Yesterday we learned this. GLONASS is used by the, of course, the European country and the NATO, North Atlantic NATO Alliance, I think. That is, and other countries with agreed to access the using the GPS P code or Y code. Whoever are in alliance with the NATO during the World War II, I think, between during the World War II, emergence of World War II, those all people have started using the GPS applications. And there will, initially the Galileo was not meant for the military applications by the Europeans, but later on they have adapted the usage of the Galileo to the military applications. So for the first military applications were with the man-operated receivers on ships and other vehicles. So for the first time, this GPS was used only in the marine applications, that is on the ships, with the man-operated. So, but as the coverage is increased with very new satellite launch, additional applications emerged, until the GPS became not only a useful tool, it became an essential capability for modern and network-centered warfare. So people have not imagined the usage of the GPS earlier, But later, it has become an essential part. It has become an essential part in every part of our life. So what are the military user equipment in the aviation, shipboard, and of course on the land, that is in the name of land navigation also we are using this GPS. So some of the of course companies that will develop the GPS receivers for these specific applications include the Magnavox Research Laboratories. Of course, later it was acquired by Hughes Aircraft and subsequently by the Raytheon. These are the company names. Some typical receivers were produced for aircraft, first in a standard avionics package that is known as a 3x4 ATR size, that is Collins 3A. But later on, it was somewhat larger in size, robustness is required. Later on, it was shrinked to a width in to half, that is 3x8 ATR. Collins and Raytheon MAGR, these three companies have collaboratively developed this 3x8 ATR technique, which is very robust in size and to man portable units. Humans can handle them very with their naked hands. Like the Collins PLGR is a GPS receiver, that is a portable GPS receiver. And of course, today we are enjoying with the DAGR, which approaches the size and weight of the commercial handheld receivers. And INS is also installed in the military aircraft because there should be integration required between the GPS and INS. Of course, we learned this in unit 4 of the last topic is this only. That is to maintain very accurate solutions regardless of the short outages to the GPS caused by the signal interference, vehicle dynamics, or sometimes antenna shading. So sometimes when we are only dependent on the GPS, there may be some of the drawbacks due to signal interference or vehicle dynamics because of the movement of the vehicles, or sometimes antenna may be shaded. So in this case, INS will be playing active role, so that there must be an integration, tightly integration must be there between the INS and the GPS. And this is one of the original image of airborne GPS receiver that was produced by Raytheon by the name MAGR 2000. Right? Okay. But far simpler integrations were performed for today's car navigation also. Systems using heading sensors, wheel counters, and the map matching. So in the car navigation also, they have used the GPS for heading the sensors, wheel counters, and also the map matching. I think whether you remember it not, during the arrival of the US President Bill Clinton, during that time, our Chandrababu Naidu was the chief minister, I remember. Whether you remember or not, during that time, you might be in your school age. They have used this technology for the first time for navigation of the US president's car. So entire transportation, that is called as intelligent transportation, ITS, was produced from US only by the usage of the GPS technology for navigating the US president. And of course, recently, Trump has also, came to India for visiting purpose. During that time also, they have used that. But for the first time, during the times of Bill Clinton, they have used that. And integrations became even more symbiotic as technology allowed for faster processors, smaller receivers, lower cost, and strap-down inertial measurement units. So these are very, very important, the integration techniques. That is too loosely coupled or tightly coupled, whatever the techniques we learned, because we are using faster processors and size has become smaller, that is smaller receivers. Of course, cost must be less and strap down inertial measurement units. Of course, today it is, we are using the GPS guided missiles and other smart weapons are becoming more, provincial. And some of the smart weapons. So now, earlier during the World War I, the people are using the, hard weapons, guns and all those things, missiles. Now the people are started using the smart weapons. That means unmanned vehicles. All these things are taken into the warfare with the unmanned vehicles. So such a sophisticated thing is enabled or possible with the help of the introduction of the GPS in the military applications. Where these will require a pinpoint accuracy, that is on the order of a few feet in some cases. So the, for the first usage of the GPS is in December 2004, there was a test occurred in which 155mm artillery shell was guided by GPS landed 3 meters from its intended target. So what they have used is 155mm artillery shell. It is a missile, I think. It is a missile, and the target is around 3 meters. The target is around the 3 meters distance, and to navigate this, and to fight this, they have used the for the first time in December 2004. So of course, GPS has become more popular from that time onwards. In the history, I think you might be knowing this very well. During the times of invasion of the Laden, I think Osama bin Laden was an international terrorist who had hidden in some interior parts of Pakistan. And of course, the US government has used the GPS technology to perfectly track him and to perfectly navigate him, and they have successfully done their project. Right? It is well known to us. I think you might be grown-ups during this time. So by combining the GPS measurements with those of onboard inertial sensors, there are onboard inertial sensors, a weapon can provide the required probability of kill with a smaller warhead than would otherwise be necessary. So earlier, crew is required. That is, army is required to invade the places to search for a particular target. But now that is being replaced or reduced with the help of the GPS enabled military equipment. Of course, earlier it was how many sorties will be necessary to kill a target, means how many vehicles required to kill a target. Now it has reversed. Using a sortie, how many targets were reached or how many targets were killed? You can understand the beauty of the GPS here. So earlier, how many vehicles are required to kill a target? But now, using a single sortie, how many targets were killed? Because a perfectly navigating and perfectly tracking is possible only with the help of the GPS. So nowadays, GPS equipped weapons are being used, of course, adapted by the many countries, right? And some more autonomous receivers include Joint Attack Direct Munitions, that is JDAM. The GPS receivers found their way into ballistic missiles, guided missiles, and some of the names are like Tomahawk, smart bombs like JDAM. So JDAM is a smart bomb, not a original bomb. Artillery shells, autonomous air vehicles, land vehicles, and also the sea vehicles. And of course, some of the recent applications are including guiding a unmanned combat air vehicle and reconnaissance drones. Some of the drones and combat vehicles with no pilot in that are the major advantages of the GPS. And of course, whenever it is going to be jammed, it can apply its own nulling techniques to jam the enemy's targets also. For these applications, anti-jam techniques are employed, such as nulling antennas. Of course, just now we heard it and we already learned in it for. And also one more technique is ultra tight coupling of the GPS and inertial sensors. One is nulling the antennas to jam the enemy's targets or enemy signals. And other one is ultra tight coupling of the GPS and inertial sensors. And inertial sensors are like onboard. They will sense if any enemy's target is coming. So that is to be tightly coupled with a GPS receiver. Then this will find out the enemy's targets and signals, and they will be nullified. Of course, in the future, we can expect higher military signal power from the satellites will further mitigate the possibility of the disruption due to the enemy jamming. And GPS-equipped precision-guided munitions quantities will be totally over 3 million in the US Air Force alone. That are 3 million in the US Air Force alone, GPS-equipped precision-guided munitions. Munitions means military equipment carrying vehicles. And JDM, that is atom smart bomb, we heard that, and this is 80% of that. Among this 3 million, 80% of them are JDAMs. The Army and Navy will buy even more units as artillery and naval gun shells become GPS guided. And here is a picture of the L3 communications munitions GPS receiver. So this is the receiver, L3 communications munitions. Munitions is a vehicle of the warfare, military vehicle, which will carry the military equipment. And this is the receiver version. And next one, after military applications, the next application is the space applications. What are the GPS applications in the space? And the first one is the NASA's Landsat. That is, Landsat is one of the satellite's name. So this is equipped with a GPS receiver. And this is the beginning of the usage of the GPS in a spacecraft. Earlier, before the introduction of the GPS, the spacecraft is launched by its own without the GPS. But when the GPS has come into the force, then the people are started integrating the GPS receivers along with the spacecraft. And the first one is the NASA's Landsat to use this. And the pictures from Landsat of the Yucatan Peninsula is a place name, coupled with a GPS equipment, airborne survey, enabled the National Geographic Expedition to find ruins of several unknown Mayan cities. See, I think in the history, we might be hear this, right? Vasco da Gama found the India, right? Vasco da Gama found the India. So there people use it to travel to the, of course, oceans using the ships or some kind of water transportation facilities, and they used to invade. And there are some tribes or certain areas which even we also don't know presently. Now, there are some unknown Mayan cities which are identified with the help of the Landsat. With the help of the Landsat. And here, the textbook author used a word, several heretofore. Heretofore means earlier. Before now, these Mayan cities were not known. But with the help of this Landsat, the expedition is made possible. If there are any defaults are there, or if any unknown areas are there, that can be even found. And GPS receivers are quite useful on spacecraft in orbit up to about 10,000 nautical miles. So you can imagine, up to about 10,000 nautical miles, they are useful. But still their visibility is present at the synchronous altitudes. The altitudes means heights. Here altitude means heights. At that height also, the synchronization is also possible. And there are different types of satellites like LEO satellites, MEO satellites. You might be learning them in satellite communication subjects. Even they are also using the GPS receivers where the altitude determination is required. And coming to the final application, of course, in detail, it is given as only ITS is given in the syllabus, that is Intelligent Transport System. Intelligent Transportation System is one of the civil navigation applications of the GPS. GPS or GNSS, of course, in conjunction, we will use these two terms.
GNSS is a global navigation system satellite. And this is using three types of satellites, GPS, Galileo, and GLONASS. These three things we know. And of course, these two are used interchangeably, GNSS or GPS, right? So major, of course, the next application of the GPS is the civil navigation. Military navigation is there. Space navigation we studied. And now we are going to study about the civil navigation. Civil navigation means we, the common people, usage of the GPS by the common people. Whatever be the transportation means. Whatever be the transportation means. But for the civil applications, the first transportation used is the marine navigation, that is on the water. So for the first time, the commercial use of GPS has began with the transit satellite navigation system. Make a note of this. The first use of the GPS in the commercial applications is transit satellite navigation system. So during the period 1965 to 1973, that is the time frame, where the GPS had to be a joint service program and it had to have a civil signal, not only a military signal, not only a space signal, but GPS should also have a civil signal. This was the concept. And the first satellites were launched in the late 1970s, of course, second quarter of the 1970 year. And it became possible to find one's time very accurately, knowing one's location whenever a satellite was visible. So time is known accurately and location is also known accurately with the usage of the satellite. Of course, if you use a three satellites, then three-dimensional positioning is possible. If you use four satellites, then three-dimensional is possible. As the number of satellites are being increased, which are used for the reception, receiving the signals, then a good navigation is possible. That is, then it grew up to 24 hours coverage. Of course, this is achieved in 1990s, where a good precision of dilution of pressure is used. Good dilution of pressure is used. Of course, we have studied in our unit 3, I think. Dilution of pressure is a satellite geometry. It should be good. There may be poor geometry is also there, but good geometric dilution of pressure is required for better navigation purposes. Of course, after many trials, this is made possible. And three types of civil navigation applications include, it is divided into three types, but only land navigation is given, that is in the name of ITS in the syllabus, but we'll study all the three. The first one is the marine navigation, land navigation, and air navigation. Of course, we have studied till now the spacecraft. Spacecraft is different and air navigation is different. Air navigation is for the civil purposes. Earlier one is for spacecrafts and we have studied military applications. But now we are studying about the air navigation exclusively for the commercial and civil application purposes. So marine navigation, land navigation, and air navigation. So first we'll talk about the marine navigation. So it is the first to embrace the satellite navigation. In when the GPS is decided to use for the civil navigation purposes, but the first time it was used in the marine navigation. But the first time it was used in the marine navigation. Along the radios and radar, a GPS receiver is a piece of standard equipment on any boat operating far from the shore. So the people are using in the ships, in the large ships, some of the radio transmitters and radio receivers, and some after a later stage, they have started using the radars. And after the, along with these radars and some radios, the introduction of the GPS receivers is also started after the marine navigation. And a typical number is around 20 million boats in North America. about 20 million boats in North America are having this facility, and worldwide there are over around 50 million. There are 50 million boats which are equipped with the radios, radar, and also a GPS receiver. And above, of this, almost 98% are pleasure craft. Happily, they are using these things. Commercial, coastal, and inland vessels comprise about 1 million potential platforms for GPS. 1 million potential platforms for GPS. And there are more than 90,000 registered merchant vessels worldwide. And most of which are involved in fishing. You see, of course, fishing is, a major business in the commercial applications. So for fishing purposes, these GPS-equipped boats are being used. So in US itself, there are 90,000 registered merchants. There may be some unregistered also, right? But registered merchants are around 90,000, which will use this GPS-equipped receivers, GPS-equipped boats for the purpose of fishing. And the International LoRaN Association, for this there is an association called International LoRaN Association, estimates that there are currently well over 1 million LoRaN sea receivers installed in North America alone. I think we have learned this, right? LoRaN sea is a long range navigation sea type. Long range navigation of sea type. In North America alone, around 1 million such GPS receivers are present. And most of these are in ships, boats, and all shipborne or not are candidates for replacement with the GPS. So these are present in the ships and boats, and also some of the shipborne vehicles. All these are replaced with the GPS. And the US Coast Guard system of differential correction broadcasts has been widely accepted, and other countries have similar systems. So each country will not depend on, one country will not depend on others' system of mathematics. Each one have developed their own techniques, of course, in the North Sea and also the Scandinavian waters. These systems provide accuracy in the 1 meters to 3 meters range. The US Coast Guard system of differential correction broadcast. So this will be around 1 meters to 3 meters range accuracy within about 150 miles of a correction beacon. So there are beacons are used, that is 150 miles beacon, correction beacon. And they yield speed over ground accuracy about 1/10 a knot, about 1/10 of a knot. The accuracy is achieved. So this is, of course, precisely it is used by many of the commercial users. And this is the history of the commercial GPS. You can note down this. You can note down this better. In early 1960s, ES Navy Transit SatNav, the project. And as the time proceeds in 1967, almost after 7 years, limited commercial use of survey and ship navigation. And in 1973, there was an oil crisis, which increased use by the oil tankers. Of course, several millions of dollars are spent over that. And there is a increased demand. So it has lowered the equipment cost for the transportation purposes of the oil. And in late 90s, this expanded the ship navigation, fishing, and also the land survey, which we learned in the previous class, for the land survey purposes by the civil engineers. Of course, over 1 lakh users are using this during that time. And in 1973, the Congress funds the MIL SatNav, military SatNav, to replace the transit and provides for the civil use. So from 1973 onwards, it has opened up for usage in the civil applications, that is commercial and civil applications, not only for the military applications. Right? Any doubts till now? Are you there in the class, guys? Hello? Okay. And the next one is the land navigation. Till now we have learnt about the marine navigation. On water, okay. And land navigation, how it has become with a different phases and with a different names. For the first time, the initial use of the GPS technology for land navigation was for fleet tracking. Fleet tracking. Fleet is nothing but the vehicles, applications, but it used for individual vehicle navigation has also grown up rapidly. Fleet tracking means a group of vehicles, which will carry some of the equipment, right? And in 2004, there were approximately 8 million GPS receivers in automobiles in the US. Of course, nowadays, MJ Actor, most of the car companies are using the GPS receivers. But for the first time in 2004, after the implementation of the GPS receivers in the, after they allow the GPS receivers in the land navigation, there are 8 million GPS receivers in the automobiles. Of course, most of the times by cars, they will implement this. At that same meeting, it was forecast that the safety improvements made via the application of GNSS technologies will reduce the annual traffic death rate to below 1 per 100 million miles driven, or about a 30% reduction from the current levels. So during that time, there was a conference held in USA, and in that conference, they have predicted that for 100 million miles driven, about 100 million miles driven, the death rate will be very, very low, less than one. That is about 30% reduction before that time. Because, why? Because whenever a GPS receiver is equipped with vehicles or automobiles, there will be a system for predicting the objects, obstacles, and they are equipped with the, of course, what we call as the safety balloons. They're also provided with the safety balloons, that is airbags. Airbags will open up whenever they hit an object. So that they have started reducing the death rate. So GPS is enabling us or helping us in reducing the accidents also. And the value of the current fleet information provided by the GNSS is evident for delivery, emergency vehicle, and scheduled service fleet dispatch and control. Not only a dispatch, but also the control. AVLS are being developed or installed in many North America's 10.3 million trucking and emergency fleets, and currently involving about 1 million vehicles in the North America. A fleet means a group of vehicles, and single individual vehicles also are coming with the GPS receivers nowadays. And Qualcomm Corporation is a pioneer in the fleet tracking with over 5 million trucks and other fleet vehicles tracked via its OmniTrax system. So Qualcomm is the company. You can also work in that. If you have prepared well for its interview, you can get a job in that. And that tracking system was called as the OmniTrax system. Many of these are GPS equipped, primarily outside the United States, particularly in the South America. So it is growing up its market. Of course, it is a market strategy. And urban transit buses, not only the long range, but also the urban within the local transportation buses are finding applications of GPS for scheduled maintenance and safety enhancement. For scheduled maintenance and safety enhancement, the urban buses, that is the local buses, are also using the GPS. Of course, nowadays we are enjoying the facility of a metro train facility, right? And this is a GPS equipped metro train we are using. Of course, all over the world, we are enjoying with the GPS equipped metro trains. The drive towards increasing the capacity of the existing transport infrastructure has spawned the emerging concept of intelligent transportation system. So what the system is called as the intelligent transportation system. So ITS is, there should not be any chance of occurrence of the accidents. There should not be any chance of occurrence of the accidents. They are properly guided like a guided missile, and the traffic is controlled in a well-designed manner. The traffic is controlled in a well-designed manner, and it will avoid the accident to a maximum extent. That means accidents will be minimized. And these systems are meant to modify the traffic flow according to the demand and other factors. Of course, this system may not be present in our country like a densely populated India, but in the other developed countries like UK or USA, there are such, the traffic flow is according to the demand. The traffic flow is according to the demand. See, in our, when you go to a traffic light signal, you can find in one direction, it will be wait. If a red signal comes, it will wait for 120 seconds. In the other direction, it will wait for 50 seconds. In the other direction, it will wait for 40 seconds. In the other direction, it will wait for 40 or 50 seconds. But in intelligent transportation system, what happens is, depending on the population density. If population density is more, means it will wait for less time. If population density is less, means it will wait for the more time. Wait for the more time. So depending on the population density, the signals are being altered. The signals are being altered. And this is the most advantageous concept of the ITS, that is intelligent transportation system. One way to do this involves the monitoring of the progress of the vehicles that are transmitting their position to a central location. So how do we know that in this direction, the population, the vehicle density is more, the traffic density is more, is because all the vehicles are equipped with a GPS receiver. Then they will send their location to a central office, And then by sitting in the central monitoring station, the people can operate the signals in any center, that is in any chaurasta, what you call in our local language. And traffic signals are rerouting signs. If traffic is more in any one direction, it will be rerouted. Of course, nowadays we find whenever some politician or some VVIP is holding a meeting in one road, the traffic personnel will reroute us to some other direction. For this, we are doing all of them manually. But if all the vehicles are GPS equipped, then it can be automated by the central office personnel itself, where a particular probe vehicle is not progressing as it should under optimum conditions. And another aspect of ITS involves automatic collection of highway and other tolls and tariffs. Of course, now it is systematized in our India also. So in earlier days, people used to stand or wait. The people used to collect the money and give the return money. But nowadays we are coming with the fast tags. Of course, whoever drives the vehicles, they might be knowing this application. Our vehicles are equipped with the fast tags. So fast tag will automatically detect the money from its account. No need to wait at the signal tolls. And of course, when we are traveling around our ORR, depending on the distance traveled, the money will be automatically detected. All these are coming under the intelligent transportation system. This will eliminate the need of vehicles to stop at state lines or at the toll booths on toll roads and bridges if their position is being reported and appropriate, accurate arrangements are made between the tariff collecting authority and the vehicle's operator. Because there should be a synchronization should be there between the tariff collecting authority and also the vehicle's operator. Of course, this is already regularized by the government authorities. We need not to wait for that. But earlier it was there, this question was there, but nowadays this question will not be there because the toll collection is, everything is regularized nowadays. This is the most appropriate for commercial operations, but it is not inconceivable that private automobiles could be subject to the same kind of system. If this is regularized by government agencies, then it is okay. But if private people, if it goes into private people hands, then it is then it will cause some of the disturbance, may not be properly used. It would be possible in early implementation to provide through lane at toll booths for appropriately equipped vehicle. Of course, at toll booths for appropriately GPS equipped vehicles, implementation is very easy. And the GPS is not only a central to this kind of technology, because the location of the required toll payment is always known. The vehicle's passing of local code trader would initiate toll billing. Yet there are another potential tariff systems where total road usage could be tracked and taxed rather than just on given road. Of course, just now I told the example of ORR, outer ring road. Of course, when we enter into one exit and where we leave the another exit, that enter through one entrance and exit at another entrance, depending on the travel distance that will collect the money. And so here there is a two different systems, revenue collection systems in USA and other one in the European Union. Of course, European Union's people will use their own Galileo, another GNSS satellite constellation. And US people will use obviously the GPS. In the United States, the Americans with Disabilities Act requires that municipal transport facilities announce and display location information to passengers with sight and hearing disabilities. So in USA, there is an act that is called Americans with Disabilities Act. So for them, through audio and through, of course, most of the times through audio, and whoever can't, of course, see for them audio, but who can see for them a display through video, location information to the passengers with sight and hearing disabilities, who cannot hear, but can see. For them, video is required. Of course, one of you are doing this as a project. I don't know. One of your batches, I have seen the heading as Intelligent Transportation System for the Disabilities. Please check out whether your system is equipped with GPS or not. So this requires both audible and visual presentations to be provided at some centers. And many transit systems do not fully comply with this requirement. Of course, a lot of feature enhancement or improvements are to be done. And systems to provide this information automatically are attractive and low cost. Right. So the GPS land navigation opportunities for GPS are in many ways, and incorporation of moving maps and databases into private passenger vehicles will generate more demand for the GPS products than all other vehicle markets combined. So if private people want to use this, then they may be GPS receivers may be equipped with the maps and some databases where about the location of the travel route. And early land-based adopters of the technology are the fleet operators, a group of vehicles. You can gain significant benefits from the efficient tracking and dispatch operations with the integrated navigation and communication. So they are navigating and also the communicating with the central office, so where they can provide better advantages. And one concept employed is called as the geofencing. Geofencing, please underline this word, where a vehicle's GPS is programmed with a fixed geographical area and alerts the fleet operator whenever the vehicle violates the prescribed geofence. So of course, this is what the US government has used it whenever their president visits another country. So there is a geofencing. Earlier, just now you might have heard biobubble in our IPL term. Biobubble is a location where it is out of the virus spread. Like this, there will be a geofencing. So geofence is something like a boundaried geographical area. And the largest operator of a GPS-based land navigation service is OnStar. The commercial name is called OnStar, and it is a General Motors subsidiary. In 2004, over 4 million vehicles were equipped with GPS receivers that communicate with OnStar operators via cell phone to provide either voice commands or map the guidance to the driver. So this is the beauty of the GPS in the land navigation. And these all come under the intelligent transportation system. These all come under the intelligent transportation system. Of course, with this I conclude, the time is up and we will study about the air navigation in our next class. Any doubts, guys? Any doubts? In land navigation, marine navigation, you can use the GPS. Air navigation, we'll study it in the tomorrow's class. So these are the civil navigation applications. And of course, space applications and smart weapons in the name of autonomous receivers in the military applications. Any doubts? I'll wait for 2 more minutes. No doubts, I will end my meeting. Shall I end my meeting? Okay, thank you for today's class. I'm stopping the class because next teacher may be in the queue.